Three, go. Everybody, welcome to Salt and Light Radio. I'm Sam Tercasio, and with me here I have Derek Newman, and this is our first episode, and we are really pumped. This is also like our 45th trial, and I think I finally got it right. That's why we were kind of joking about the coffee there at the beginning, but we're getting kind of our natural vibe. It takes a few times, but here we are in studio with Derek, the D-Man Newman. I just came up with that. I don't know if you like that. We got Jay Mai in the booth, Jason Myers, and I'm Sam. Some call me Torque. What did you guys used to call me? Moose? Wasn't that a...
Yeah, I think Moose, yeah.
Garrett had that for me. Whatever you guys want to call me, that's all right. Some call me Torque. This will be available on my YouTube channel, Torque Coffee, because I love coffee. And if you get a YouTube channel, you can upload it to yours.
Yeah.
So, hey, man, this is good. I'm excited. So,
yeah.
Salt and Light Radio, you actually came up with that. What was the thinking behind that? I like it.
Yeah. I feel like there's just so many podcasts going on right now. There's a lot of content out there, a lot of good Christian podcasts that we watch and we talk
Fight,
about.
Fight, Laugh, Feast.
Fight, Laugh, Feast.
Big inspiration.
The Dividing Line with James White.
Come on.
Some beautiful stuff. Jeff Durbin, Apologia.
Apologia, yeah. Do some good stuff.
But yeah, no, I just thought that Salt and Light would be a good title. My idea behind this was, how could we be a blessing and salt and light in a world that is, you know, not living with God's word as the standard? And how can we challenge those, you know, ideas that are against God's word?
And talking a lot of big picture stuff, but then we want to try to apply it to Western New York.
Yes.
To make it something that Western New Yorkers can turn into and apply it to our city and the dynamic of the church here.
Yep.
Because we can only focus on one corner of the church at the time, right?
Yeah.
And so we really feel that there's a need to talk about issues and relate them to what's going on here, right?
Yep, absolutely.
So, Salt and Light Radio Show, we're going to try to do these every so often. We do thank our Lord Jesus Christ. We gave this to him before we started, and we had some technical issues, but he got us through. So, this is all about proclaiming his kingdom. And so, first we wanted to talk a little bit about being salt and light in society. We want to make a difference in society. You know, that's what this is all about, man. So you have it pulled up.
Yeah.
Why don't you read that scripture there in Matthew 5?
Yeah, so salt and light, that term, that phrase comes from the Gospel of Matthew chapter 5, verse 13, which states, "You are the salt of the earth, but if salt has lost its taste, how shall its saltiness be restored? It is no longer good for anything except to be thrown out and trampled under people's feet." And then verse 14 says, "You are the light of the world. A city set on a hill cannot be hidden, nor do people light a lamp and put it under a basket, but on a stand, and it gives light to all in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before others, so that they may see your good works and give glory to your Father who is in heaven."
The importance of good works.
Yeah.
So salt is a preserver.
Yes.
It keeps things from decaying. It keeps things from going wrong. And then light is a guide in the darkness.
Yeah.
And Christ said that that's what we're to be. And so we are to, and I think you could see this, I mean, I know you can see this in history, that the church has been that preserver, keeping society and the world from going totally, just totally rotten. And then with the gospel, we've been the light, giving the people the hope in a very dark world.
Yeah.
And you could, you know what, maybe even 20 years ago, you could not understand that from a cultural vantage point like you can now. But we've been living off Christian capital for a long time.
Amen.
And we've been taking for granted the thinking and the stability that a biblical worldview and a Christian mindset brings to society.
Yeah.
And people have said, well, I don't want God, but of course I want a stable society where I can make money and be... Oh, come on. That may get edited out. We'll see. but he got excited. The mic got excited. But you know, people want the benefits of a stable society, but now... Brother Derek, you're seeing all that. We don't even know what a man and a woman is. When Facebook says, don't censor us, when Facebook says there's 57 genders, are you crazy? Am I insane or are they insane? Are we insane?
No.
Isn't it, and you wouldn't have thought 20 years ago that you need the Bible to tell you what a man and a woman is.
Right.
And you shouldn't. Because it's clear in nature, but we need that special light to guide us, and it's one of the reasons God gave it. Not the only reason, but even our common sense goes awry without God. Comment on that a little bit.
No, you were going exactly where I wanted to go in this thought, and I've been reading a lot of stuff on the Puritans and what the Puritans done to build that foundation of Christian thought in America, liberty of conscience,
freedom,
capitalism, freedom of religion, all these things that we are blessed to have came from Christians and their foundation of America. And we're definitely, here we are in 2021, 200, 300 years removed of, our independence.
Yep.
And here we are, and we've gotten away from the standard that the Puritans looked to, which was the Word of God.
Right.
The Word of God is to be what influences the standard by what influences all of life, and now we're basically making our decisions, our culture's making decisions and making pronouncements based on the wisdom of man rather than the wisdom of God.
Right. And this is ties into another thing that we wanted to bring up: why a strong doctrine of the church is important. And what's wrong with American evangelicalism? Because the Puritans had a very strong doctrine of Christ's church. You mean they originally, the Puritans were a diverse group. There were many different convictions within Presbyterian. Oh boy. Many different, you've had your Presbyterians, you had your Baptists, and a lot of them were Calvinists, but not all of them were. Many of them were post-mill, some of them were pre-mill. I mean, there were a diverse group. Even some were heretics within that diverse group called the Puritans. But generally speaking, when we refer to Puritans, we're referring to men that were doctrinally sound.
Right.
John Gill, John Bunyan, Richard Sibbes, Richard Baxter, these men that believed in the power of the Word of God and believed in the importance of the local church. And I think, kind of even going back a little further, Derek, at the time of the Reformation, because you have the Reformation era, and then after that, one of the next big eras is the Puritan era, where the Puritans now took the Reformation teaching, which was biblical teaching, and then started really applying it to everyday life and everyday situations. At the Reformation, the reformers brought back the clarity of the gospel that saves our souls, and they had to declare that. And the reformers didn't see themselves as separating from the church, but they saw themselves from separating from Rome or the Roman church, and they saw the Roman church as corrupt. And so the gospel was brought back. You had the Puritan era, and one of the things that a lot of the Puritans brought back was the importance of individual salvation. This goes back to the Pietists too, that they wanted to make sure there was an emphasis on knowing you're saved. In other words, not going to a church has saved you, and that's important. going fast forwarding up to now the 20th century, the 1900s, you have men like Billy Graham who preach the gospel so clearly, and we're thankful for what Billy did. But American evangelicalism really lost its doctrine of the church, and again, linking this with the Reformation, the Reformers had a strong doctrine of the church, but they were still reacting to Rome. And somehow over the centuries, the children of the Reformation have lost the vitalness and the importance of the church. And I'll say one more thing and I'll let you go. And yeah. I'm gonna just share from personal experience. I was talking historically, but I was raised Roman Catholic, and with all due respect, I hope my Roman Catholic family's listening. Going to church was a part of how you maintained your salvation. It was a part of in Roman Catholicism, you could fall out of grace. So Roman Catholicism is essentially sacramentalism. You got to keep taking the sacraments to be saved, and obviously every church service, or what they call it, a mass, was the Eucharist, and Christ is being offered up again. So it was very important that you partake of the Eucharist to keep your eternal life. Protestant Christians, Reformed Christians, and rightly, I believe, understand that going to church doesn't save you. Amen?
Amen.
Only a relationship with Christ does. But what I've noticed, and I'm 38 now, Derek. I left the Roman Church around 20. And so I've been on both sides of the Tiber River for an equal amount of time. Obviously, I was older and more mature on one side. But one thing that I notice in contemporary evangelicalism is, the kindest way I can say it, is a kind of apathy towards the church. It's almost like, since church doesn't save my soul, it's nice if I make it.
Right.
When you want to bounce off that a little, you know where I'm going.
Yeah.
Can I feel where I'm going with that?
So, you know, kind of back to the Puritans, I want to just piggyback off some of those thoughts and then lead into that. A lot of what they taught was personal piety, personal holiness, personal integrity. So, living a holy life behind closed doors and in the public square, not just doing the right things and the good works so that you can be seen by others,
right,
which Jesus warns us against, but living that holy life in private too. And I think when the church is living like that, they're going to be stronger together. When they're constantly being compromised personally, when they gather as a body, it almost just seems like they're weak. They're weakening the body, so to speak. You know.
And just to piggyback off that, the Puritans and their emphasis on living a holy life, they almost picked up on the other side of what the Reformers were saying—that we're justified by faith alone, but good works follow salvation.
Yes.
They don't cause salvation, but they follow. And then the Puritans really picked up on that and said, you don't live a holy life to be saved, but you should live a holy life.
And that's the whole aspect of that salt and light.
I
think that's really where they got it right, is they were trying to apply God's word to everything that they did, to their families, to their education, obviously to the church, their jobs, their businesses, their dealings with their neighbors. So, I think where the disconnect is at the pulpit. I think when you have pastors and our educators and our leaders that aren't deep thinkers, that aren't doing their research and doing good study, they're not going to be able to properly teach their people the pure gospel. You know what I mean?
Absolutely.
So So if they're just getting kind of like a little fluffy, happy message on Sunday, and then they leave the body, the worship gathering, and go out into the world, they don't really have any teeth behind what they're going to do on that Monday through Saturday, right?
Right.
In their dealings with their wives, their kids, their schools, their jobs.
Right.
So I think that back to your question about we have to have a strong doctrine of the church, I think it really starts with the Word of God being accurately, precisely, carefully preached to the people so that the people can go out and be that salt and light to the world or the sphere that they're in.
That's right. Because first of all, we're going to find the doctrine of the church, or what we might call ecclesiology, in the Word of God. It's going to be contained in the Word of God. And then also, it's the church that brings the people the Word of God. And we should define church. I just used a fancy word, cause ecclesiology, which is the doctrine of the ecclesia, which the ecclesia is the ek, ek out in the ecclesia, called. So the called out ones, in sum, is what I'm trying to say. The church, biblically speaking, is the called out ones. And so we're in a church right now.
Yeah.
We're in a church right now. And the church is not a building. Doesn't mean the building is unimportant. I mean, you're not going to meet out in the field in the middle of winter. You need a building. But the church is the people.
Yeah.
And that's important. Yeah. That's an important, and it's God's people.
Yeah.
And it's the place where we hear the Word of God, where we hear what God has to say to us. And that's the main thing. But we know the Word of God also tells us that it's the place where we remember Him in the Lord's Supper, and where we proclaim Him in baptism. All of these things are important. And you even see in the church, Derek, not only is there a kind of sort of apathy, or here's an even better word that I think hits, a casual attitude towards it. That's better than apathy.
I like that, yeah.
And apathy might be a little harsh, though it exists, but I think casual captures it much better.
Yes.
There is way too casual an attitude towards the church and the assembly. There's a casual attitude towards baptism where just not seeing it as urgent, not seeing it as important. We can talk about modes of baptism, come on, later. But would you agree that there's, and even the Lord's Supper.
Yeah.
And sometimes in our overreaction to Rome, we're, you know, it's not like time to just joke and it's not trivial. I mean, we're still remembering Him, and yes, it's a symbol, but it's a pretty important symbol. Come on.
Yeah. Yeah, no, I think you nailed it with a casual approach. I think that's perfectly said. God cares how He's worshipped.
That's
I understand maybe how we got here from the Protestant Reformation, because we wanted to separate ourselves from a lot of the traditions that were elevated over Scripture. So maybe we take, oh man, we're free in Christ, we're justified by faith, and that's all good, and we love that, and amen. However, within that framework, we still should come to worship with a holy reverence for the Lord and worship properly. There's proper forms of worship, and there's improper forms of worship. You see that all throughout Scripture. God cares how He's worshipped.
Yeah. Absolutely. And in a certain sense, we're talking about two different components. One, our attitude toward the church, toward God and the church, and what the church is, big picture. And I think that the Reformation was extremely vital in recovering the gospel. And I believe that even for originally, they maintained a strong doctrine of the church, and that went into the Puritan era. And so I'm still trying to figure out, and I think this is part of what we wanted to talk about, is how the, and we're going to focus on America. So, I mean, I know we can look around the world. Yeah. I know that I even talked to some missionary friends in Italy where, you know, in Italy you think Roman Catholicism, of course, it's 99% of the population, but even the evangelical church there needs help. So by no means is it just here, but when we're talking about specifically an American problem, how did the American doctrine of the church become so weak? And we're going to talk about how this was exposed about a year ago.
Yeah.
But trying to figure it out, Derek, and I didn't plan to say this, but if I may say, I think that as evangelical Christians, and evangelical is another way of saying Protestant. It's the evangel, the gospel. We're gospel Christians. It's kind of the positive side of what we are. And then the Protestant is that we protest wrong. Well, that word has a history that's a little bit more in depth that we won't get into here. But looking at, I still think perhaps there's always been work to do. And I think this century is going to be a significant century for, and I think it's going to be guys in our generation. Because you hear sometimes a lot of the older people thinking that our generation wants fluff. We don't. We want the meat of God's word. Yeah. Amen?
Amen.
We see right through the smoke, literally the smoke, yeah, on your stage when, yeah, you're singing worship. I mean, I'm not,
yeah,
blasting you for that, but, you know, that's kind of a double play on the idea. But a lot of times, you could have a good church with smoke on your stage. I'm not saying you can't, but a lot of times, well, that kind of coincides with, let's be honest, seeker-sensitive, kind of watered-down,
yeah,
preaching. But where I'm going with this is that we need to develop a strong doctrine of the church, and I think that one of the things that I'm beginning to see is the emphasis of the local church. To have that concept of the Catholic Universal Church and the local church. When I see the Catholic, not the Roman Catholic, but the, maybe we'll talk about this another time, but the general term, the general church, the church worldwide, the professing church, I see a lot of issues. But Derek, we can't fix the general church. We can only fix the local church in our area, which is why we want to have an emphasis on Western New York.
Yeah.
And I think we really need to emphasize the importance of bringing reform and biblical teaching to your local churches, because I think that that's the answer to, I'm going to make this short because I could go on forever, denominationalism gone awry. And I almost wonder if in this concept of American Christianity, we have prioritized. And you even hear this. This is why we need to do stuff like this, because conservatism without Christ is empty. And even some of our favorite conservative speakers, even the ones that say they're born-again Christians, there's more of an emphasis on everyone's... You don't hear Christ's lordship proclaimed. Christ is... I even heard, I'll say it, and I got a lot of respect for the guy, Mark Levin. He's got a new book coming out, American Marxism. I'm sure it's going to be beautiful. But at the end of his show the other day, great show, he was saying that we've got to stand for these conservative values, and we got to put our small differences aside. And he included faith among small differences. That is not a small difference. Jesus Christ is Lord of life. So yes, while I can rejoice with a Muslim friend who wants to stand for with sanctity of life, or a Roman Catholic, I rejoice. But what's more important? The truth, their soul, them hearing the gospel. So I think a part of it may have been this sort of, you know, while the American dream is a blessing, the pursuit of happiness and all that, it's almost become a false priority, a false God, because God's main, we do know from Scripture and even the great confessions that God wants us to enjoy Him forever, and He wants us to enjoy the life, but God wants us to know Him. Mm-hmm. And happiness is not the be-all, end-all. And I think that the church has kind of been sleeping under the American dream. While the prosperity that this and the freedom this country has enjoyed is great, it's not the be-all, end-all. There's a God. There's a judgment. And so all that to say is we've gotten our priorities mixed up in the American church. And then another thing, too, to say is, again, and I've just been emphasizing it, but as important as salvation is, many American Christians stop there. They stop with, well, as long, you know, you're saved, your soul's secure. They kind of just stop there. And it seems that for many of them, pursuing the American dream and having your kids enrolled in all the sports, and here's how this plays out, having your kids in all the sports and all the activities, and some of that's good, but going to Bible club, getting your kids catechized, this stuff has kind of gone by the wayside because that sanctification and that purity that the Puritans emphasize so strongly has just been gone. And go ahead.
I think it's a truncated view of the gospel. That view of just my individual salvation, and then now I'm just going to end there, and then pursue the American dream, like you discussed. The mindset for the Christian needs to be: now I'm in God's kingdom. Now what can I do with the time that He's given me to expand and advance His kingdom? What can I do?
Right.
What can I do at work? What can I do with my family? What can I do with my neighbors? What can I do in my church? That needs to become the scope, because it's not just individual salvation, it's over, and then just wait for Christ to return.
Get right. to work. Right.
And be that, like we said in the beginning of this podcast, be that salt and light that God has called you to be.
And that is hard work.
Yeah, and that's that's the way the kingdom grows, a mustard seed. It's a process, and we're supposed to put out those seeds and watch God progressively bring more and more folks into His kingdom.
That's right. And so the last thing that we had talked about that we wanted to address is nowhere has this been more exposed, this weakness of the American evangelical church, than with the COVID-19 situation that our country was entered into. And you saw churches shutting down. Now, whether churches should have shut down originally is maybe a discussion for another day. I'm coming to the conviction that Even in the face of a plague or a crisis, the church of all places needs to be open. Those that can't come for whatever reason is understandable. But that being said, many churches were seemingly more than happy to be closed indefinitely. You have men like Andy Stanley saying that Jesus never commanded us to gather, which is absurd on every level, because that the doctrine, the very word at church itself is about the gathering people, and all throughout even the Old Testament it was the people gathered together to worship the Lord. So that's the whole point. Yeah. And we could get into a whole refutation of that, but that's and you had some, and this is where we might bring it a little bit local, that seem to think that Romans 13 means that, tell me if I'm putting this succinctly, or maybe we could say it another way, that Romans 13, because this to me seems to be the interpretation some have of Romans 13, that Romans 13 teaches that the government can tell you how to run your church. Is that what Romans 13 is teaching?
No, it's not. And unfortunately, I think that's how a lot of churches have treated this pandemic. They got their marching orders from the government rather than the word of God. And that's why you've seen so many churches just close their doors outright or bring in just very strict rules and regulations, 6 feet apart, masks, no singing or sing with a mask on, those type of practices you've seen all over the church. And unfortunately, it was far more prevalent than you'd think.
And I think that that exposed our weak ecclesiology, our weak teaching on the church, because if we knew that Jesus was the Lord of the church, not the government, not Caesar, if we knew that he does in fact command us to get together and to worship him, if we knew those things, we would know that the government has no place in all, at all in dictating what the church does and how she worships. Romans 13 very clearly is about the government's responsibility to punish evil and to reward good.
Yeah.
It has nothing to do with, but someone will say, well, you guys are right, but in the case of some kind of sickness or plague or ailment, the government does have a right to tell your church what to do. And I'm thinking, wait a minute. Jesus said the gates of hell will not prevail against the church. Did Jesus know that sickness and disease would be in this world? Because, first of all, on the first level, if the government can close us down or tell us what to do because of some kind of sickness or danger, there's no end to that.
Yeah.
And secondly, do we trust the government? And a lot of the people are just taking what the CDC says as law. Why are we allowing the CDC and the guidelines they set forth to dictate to us how we're to worship? And someone might say, well, it's a part of showing respect and being peaceable and being a good witness to them and our neighbors. And I understand that to a certain degree, Derek, but when it's dividing your congregation, no matter how nice you put it, that's not right. I mean, you want to bounce off that?
Yeah, I think the reformers put it best when they said there's different spheres in this world, spheres of government. You have the civil government, you have the church, and you have the family.
Right.
And unfortunately, they all have different roles. You know, the church's role is to bring word and sacrament to the people. The family meant to nurture and bring their children up in the nurture and admonition of the Lord and be a blessing to the world. And the civil government, like you mentioned with Romans 13, meant to punish the evildoer and praise the good. And what we've seen is, I think, and certainly in America, and you've seen this in other countries too, is the sphere of civil government has gotten so inflated that now they want to overstep what they were naturally designed by God to do.
Right.
God's design for the civil government, again, per Romans 13, is to punish the evil and to praise the good. And now what the government is doing, and I think because the church has become compromised, they're looking to the government for guidance, like we said. They're looking to the government for guidance when a pandemic hits or when there's a public health crisis, rather than scripture and what you can deduce from scripture. Just a quick caveat. In history, and I've read this recently, I can't give you an exact date or which plague it was, but I remember reading about how Christians responded to different plagues in history, and it was some beautiful stuff. Christians would put their own health at risk to try to aid people that were going through different difficulties, black plague, disease, hurting, trying to help them through their sufferings. Because in those moments, they were more concerned with their eyes on their treasure in heaven and serving their Lord than their own health.
Amen.
And we need to have, we as the church, we need to have a fear of the Lord and look to the kingdom and his kingdom rather than our comforts and whether or not we're going to get sick. I'm not advocating let's be reckless and foolish.
Right.
Certainly the CDC has its place and its guidance, but let's use wisdom. Let's hear what they have to say, and let's say, is this a good idea? Should the church adopt this? Should we mandate these things that our people need to do? They need to wear masks? Or should we, like the Bible says, make it a conscience, a liberty of conscience thing, where if you are in fear of this sickness, wear a mask, wear a hazmat suit, wear whatever you want, but come and freely worship. Don't stay home. We need to be with the body of Christ for our own benefit.
Well, let's bounce off that. Yeah. Let's bounce off that. Here's a scenario. Let's say we had a plague in this country, and this is not what we had, but literally every other person was dropping dead, like literally. Let's just say that that's happening, which probably means either you are or Jason wouldn't be here. I mean, it would be that bad.
Yeah.
Do we close down the church? I'm gonna say no, and here's why. Do I understand if people that are susceptible or even scared don't want to come? Of course I understand. But here I'll just talk from a pastor's perspective. The church needs to be open, and I need to be here. I need to put myself on the front lines. I know I'm saying something bold, but it's just, I think, for anyone that needs prayer, you know, even if that's all that it is, these doors need to be open for people that need prayer, for people that need the word. These doors need, do I understand if some people don't want to come? Yeah. And as a minister, we're going to find a way to get them communion, get them the word.
Yeah.
But I don't think the church closes. I think of all places we need to be open.
That's exactly what I was going to say.
And doing the one another's too, right?
Yeah, that's exactly. How much more do you need the church during a deadly plague?
Exactly, you know, for prayer and all that stuff. Not to mention
people losing loved ones, going through insurmountable sufferings. How much more do they need the benefits that come from the word and sacrament than any other time?
Absolutely. And again, that doesn't mean we don't understand. Some people are going to stay away. Well, we're obviously going to be careful, but these doors need to be open, and the government shouldn't be rearing its ugly head in here. And so to have different sections of the church where you're dividing the fellowship because of CDC guidelines, the question is why? Why are we following the CDC guidelines? Jesus Christ is the Lord of the church. And if we don't stand up to guidelines that restrict and limit our fellowship, we're basically binding the church to the state, to Caesar. But I think you got to encourage people to just be responsible, use their own discretion. Because these are matters of liberty, whether you're vaccinated or not, whether you're wearing a mask or not. And I just don't think we should be letting these guidelines divide the church into sections. I just see that as, with all due respect, I just see that as dangerous and going in the wrong direction. We want to fellowship. We want to do things for the Lord. So within reason, we need to fellowship. We need to encourage. And if it, you know, we can't be that afraid of death.
Yeah.
Because look, Jesus says, as we see these kind of things happen in the world, we're to look up, for our redemption draws nigh. And I don't think he meant to look up in our basement. I think he meant to look up together with him as his people worshiping him. So we've kind of done a smorgasbord here. Maybe in future episodes we'll because we kind of hit on a lot of things, but maybe we'll develop some things more in the future. I know that we want to talk eschatology in the future, and how that connects to our kingdom ethic.
Have
and
a couple special guests for that.
Have a couple special guests. Yep, absolutely. So Jason, could you cue that music back up? Derek, any concluding thoughts?
No, just this was a great discussion. I hope folks are challenged to think through these things a little bit more and are blessed by the conversation.
Absolutely. Well, thank you for joining us on the first edition of Salt and Light Radio. We look forward to doing this again. Bye-bye.
Yes, Israelites, they said you saw.